मोर मिनट्स, 11:10 आई
ओके
विल स्टार्ट। चला वेट पा कार्तिका।
हाँ यस मैम, आई विल कॉल द अदर्स हु डिडंट जॉइन मैम।
ओके हेलो।
हाँ यस मैम, वी कैन स्टार्ट द क्लास मैम।
ओके गुड मॉर्निंग। सो आई होप एवरीवन आर सेफ एट होम, राइट?
यस
एवरीवन
मैम।
एट होम? यस। ओके सो आई जस्ट बी अटेंटिव फॉर 20 to 30 मिनट्स। यू कैन बी इंटरेक्टिव एज दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक। माय टॉपिक इज जेस्टेशनल डायबिटीज मेलिटस। So it's very common in our country. Being a Asian ethnicity, the incidence is very high. So it's a very important topic as a pregnancy point of view as well, as it has got preventive methods so that we don't get on with maternal and fetal complications. Okay. So the definition of GDM is very important. It is carbohydrate intolerance of variable severity with onset of first recognition during pregnancy. So what does this mean? So first time you're diagnosing a woman with diabetes mellitus during pregnancy, that is carbohydrate intolerance. You are doing a blood sugar and that is supposed to be raised values. Okay. Am I clear? All
Yes,
of you
ma'am.
can just say yes. Yeah. So we screen all the pregnant women And I hope you have seen how we are screening. You have heard about this DIPSI guideline, Diabetes and Pregnancy Study Group in India, DIPSI guideline. Anyone? So, which year are you in?
I'm finally, ma'am.
Finally, yeah. So, you must have seen in our clinics, no? You have come during your clinics, second year?
Yes, ma'am. We have come for a few days, ma'am.
OG postings. Yes, so, ma'am. You must have seen the sugars written as OGCT. Have you seen in the notebook, oral glucose challenge test? Yes? No. Not seen? Kartika, yeah. I know your name.
Ma'am, I have not seen any notebooks. No.
Okay. So you need to know that we are screening all the women. It's a screening test to diagnose. Okay.
Yes.
So coming to this, GDM, here again they have classified as A1 and A2. A1 is diet control GDM. That means the sugars can be controlled with diet alone. A2 is medication controlled. That is GDM that requires medications like metformin or giving insulin. Okay. So, first of all, we need to understand what is the glucose metabolism in pregnancy. Whatever intake by the mother, it's being utilized by the baby. So, the mother always remains in the fasting hypoglycemia. Because all the diet what she takes is given to the fetus, continuous fetal utilization of glucose, irrespective of the maternal glucose level. That is, fetus continues to be fed even if the mother starves. This is called as fasting hypoglycemia. So, when you take a blood sugar for a mother, it will be around 60 to 80. Unlike in normal women who may be having a values less than 100. Okay. So, this changes mainly fasting hypoglycemia and increase insulin resistance. And there is an increase in the postprandial glucose, which we call it as postprandial hyperglycemia. And exaggerated insulin secretion in response to glucose. So, there is increased insulin, but the action of insulin is not responded in the peripheral receptors. And destruction of insulin by the placental insulinase hormone. So, this increased production of insulin is destroyed by the insulinase, which is secreted by the placenta. And also increase in the hepatic glucose output. Okay. So, whenever there is an increased insulin resistance, what happens? Peripheral resistance to insulin increases gradually as pregnancy advances. This is due to the increased level of diabetogenic placental hormones. That is the most important being the human placental lactogen. And also other hormones like tumor necrosis factor alpha. So you need to know which are the substances which increase the insulin resistance. Am I clear or am I going very fast?
No, ma'am. It's clear, ma'am.
Okay. So you need to know some hormones, that is the human placental lactogen, the estrogen and progesterone of pregnancy, cortisol, prolactin, tumor necrosis factor alpha, C-reactive protein and interleukin-6. So what happens in... I told you about fasting hypoglycemia. Then we have this postprandial hyperglycemia. What happens because of this insulin resistance? This leads to decreased uptake of glucose by the cells and consequently there is an increased postprandial hyperglycemia. Both increased insulin resistance and placental insulin destruction by the insulinase, they necessitate increased insulin secretion by the beta cells. Thereby there is an increased secretion always. Despite this increased insulin, hepatic glucose output continues due to lack of inhibition of glucagon. Glucagon is not inhibiting this. An increase in the HPL, human placental lactogen, this all leads to have a diabetogenic state in pregnancy. You need to remember pregnancy is the diabetogenic state. Any woman who does not have diabetes also may develop diabetes. So this progressive increase in hyperglycemia and insulin result resistance results in increased production of insulin by the pancreas. Because of this, the pancreatic response is inadequate and overt abnormality of glucose tolerance occurs. This diabetogenic hormones, they peak the level. I told you about certain hormones, the human placental lactogen, estrogen, progesterone, cortisol, prolactin. All these tends to increase at 24 to 28 weeks. That is a glucose intolerance usually manifests at this time. That is why we are actually doing the screening test between 24 to 28 weeks. if the patient doesn't come in the first trimester. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So who are the women to screen? Any pregnant woman is supposed to be screened for diabetes, unlike in Western world where they screen only the high-risk women. Like they screen only women who have Asian ethnicity or when there is a GDM in a previous pregnancy, impaired glucose tolerance or glucosuria. That is, we used to take the glucose testing in the urine sample. If it is positive, they used to do. But in our country, we are doing for all women. But you need to know who are high-risk women to give importance. And also whenever there is a strong family history of type 2 diabetes in the first degree relatives, like having a mother with diabetes, father with diabetes, or maternal aunt, uncle, like they all come in second degree. But if there are many second degree relatives also, you need to worry. But give importance to first degree relatives, okay? And also when the maternal age is more than 25, maternal birth weight of a previous baby more than 4 kg, when you know about this corpus cancer syndrome, when a woman is having a PCOS, obesity with metabolic syndrome, those women tend to have a diabetes in future life. How we say they have a increased tendency for CA endometrium as well. That is what we call as corpus cancer syndrome. So these women also tend to have an increased risk for having a diabetes. Okay. And also whenever there is a woman who's on glucocorticoids or hypertension, they also tend to have increased incidence of developing diabetes. When the pre-pregnancy BMI is more than 30 or in Asians, it is just more than 27.5, there is an increased risk of having diabetes. And when she develops weight gain, either in early adulthood or between pregnancies, excessive gestational weight gain, that is GWG, during pregnancy, they have to increase by 10 to 12 kg. But if there is an increase more than that, we have to think of having a diabetes. And also previous poor obstetric outcome. You have to inquire about the previous obstetric history. Whenever she has delivered a baby more than 4 kg or there was a shoulder dystocia, developing a brachial plexus, unexplained perinatal loss, hypertension, polyhydramnios, congenital anomaly baby, or neonatal hypoglycemia and glycosuria at the first prenatal visit. Okay. So we all know whom we are going to screen, all the women, and how are we going to screen? But by doing what test? I told you about DIPSI guideline, Diabetes in Pregnancy Study Group in India. So we call him Sheshaya, Sheshaya's test. So it is a one-step test wherein we are going to give oral glucose 75 grams mixed in either water or lemon juice and ask her to drink when she comes to the OP, irrespective of her previous meal. Don't bother whether she has taken a breakfast or she has taken a good night meal. Okay, give her glucose and ask her to take the blood test after 2 hours. And the cutoff for this DIPSI, this is why I'm saying DIPSI guideline, that is a national guideline which is accepted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. In 2018, they have accepted this, and the value more than or equal to 140, we say she is a gestational diabetes. More than 120, it is decreased gestational glucose tolerance, or we call it as impaired glucose tolerance. More than 200 is diabetes mellitus. So, if the woman vomits within 30 minutes of the oral glucose load, then the test should be repeated the next day. Don't repeat the same day. If vomiting occurs more than 30 minutes, the test can be continued. Okay. This is recommended screening twice during the antenatal period. One, when she comes in the first trimester, and the next to confirm between 24 to 28 weeks. Okay. If the first test is negative. At least there should be an interval of 4 weeks between the test. If the woman is first seen after 28 weeks, the test is performed only once at the first visit. Okay. So previously we were doing that two-step test by giving 100 grams glucose. We are just doing this test now in the Government of India. So whenever in the exam they are asking, just say this DIPSI guideline. Okay. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Remember, 75 grams, 200 ml of water, irrespective of the previous meal, then take the sugar values after 2 hours. This is what we are doing in our OP. Okay. Now, why are we so much bothered? Because the incidence of gestational diabetes is on the rise because of our diet. Mainly we eat, we are all carbohydrate consuming, rice eaters. Okay. And also belonging to Asian ethnicity. So what are the maternal complications? Mainly they can have preeclampsia in women with diabetic nephropathy and vasculopathy. And hypertension itself may predate pregnancy in many type 2 diabetics. So you need not get confused with diabetes and GDM. Type 2 diabetes is when women have diabetes even prior to pregnancy. GDM develops during pregnancy, or is it, it's diagnosed during pregnancy. Okay. So they can have polyhydramnios, that is mainly because of maternal hyperglycemia leading to fetal hyperglycemia and fetal polyuria. So this increased amniotic fluid glucose is also responsible for this features what the mother develops, polyhydramnios. Because of this, there can be respiratory compromise, breathlessness in the mother. And they can develop infections like candidiasis, urinary tract infection, and later following delivery, there can be puerperal sepsis, infection, lactation failure. Okay. And polyhydramnios after rupture, they can also develop chorioamnionitis. Okay. These two tends to have a woman to deliver early. That is called preterm labor. And there can be operative vaginal delivery and cesarean section, mainly for fetal macrosomia, because the birth weight may be more if the mother does not have a good control of her sugar values. Okay. So the fetal complications mainly will be sometimes if the woman is over-diabetic. Over-diabetic means that she has diabetes prior to pregnancy. They can have spontaneous miscarriage, and the congenital anomaly rate is comparatively higher in a woman with diabetes earlier to pregnancy. There can be fetal growth restriction if she has developed complications with vasculopathy. Otherwise, it is a macrosomia baby. In GDM, also if she is not controlled, there can be macrosomia. In the ultrasound, you can have an abdominal circumference which is grossly increased. And also they can develop polyhydramnios, prematurity, and late intrauterine death. The baby may die in utero for reasons not found out. Okay. So if it is a diabetic pregnancy, you need to bother about what are the infections, and the mother may develop urinary tract infection, vulval candidiasis. You need to treat those infections. And congenital anomalies from head to toe, the baby may have central nervous system anomalies like anencephaly, spina bifida, holoprosencephaly, cardiac anomaly like ventriculoseptal defect, transposition of great vessels and tetralogy of Fallot. Renal, she can have agenesis and cystic kidney, caudal regression syndrome, which we call it as mermaid baby. Kadal kanni mari irko. The lower part of the body may not be developed at all. Okay, that is quite common with diabetic pregnancy, less common with gestational diabetes mellitus. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And they tend to have over diabetes. They may have this ketonemia and hypoglycemia. They also may become unaware. They may faint. That is one easy form which can be corrected by just giving 25% dextrose as a solution. If a woman with diabetes faints, you need to be very aware that she has gone for hypoglycemia or ketoacidosis. You have to think both of them in your mind. And so this is about maternal and fetal complications. And whenever the baby is delivered, so how do you control gestational diabetes? So preconceptional care is very important.
Ma'am, you are muted, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, Pam. Disturbance here.
Yes, ma'am.
So, what happens is preconceptually, we have to screen them if she had a diabetes GDM earlier. Okay. And obese women including PCOS, should be advised to lose weight prior to pregnancy, and they should be counseled about acceptable weight gain during pregnancy. And they should be advised on target plasma glucose levels, like fasting less than 95, 1 hour postprandial less than 140, 2 hour postprandial less than 120. They should be advised about diet. What is this diet like? It is called the medical nutritional therapy, MNT. Okay, the caloric restriction of these women is very important. They have to be advised on what is a protein diet like. I'll give you a chart to say how the diet should be. Like, they have to be advised on taking split meals and split breakfast, like 7 o'clock a cup of milk, 9 o'clock to have 2 idlis, 11 o'clock again 2 idlis, and 1 o'clock they are supposed to have a bit of rice with lot of vegetables, and at 3 o'clock some protein. Like, in the hospital we have this diabetic diet where they give sundal, meduvada or some cucumber. At 5 o'clock a cup of milk without sugar, and 7 o'clock to have some chapati, roti, which does not have much of carbohydrate. A wheat is important. Okay, so mainly the normal weight caloric intake should be around 30 kilocals per kg. For overweight, if the woman is normal weight, if her BMI is between 25 to 29.9, that is overweight or obese, more than 30, then they should be advised to have 22 to 24 kilocals per kg, and morbidly obese should have a kilocals between 15 kilocals per kg. Carbohydrate should be around 40%, fat around 40%, protein around 20%. And distribution should be 3 main meals and 2 to 3 snacks. Okay. So, taking the body mass index prior to pregnancy is very important, and asking them to lose weight is important. This is called this medical nutritional therapy. I told you about A1 GDM. And now also you have to advise them about exercise. Moderate exercise day, at least 5 days a week is recommended. This reduces the need for insulin and achieves better glycemic control. We are supposed to give
ma'am. Sorry ma'am, your voice is breaking, we can't hear you ma'am.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. It's not audible now.
Yeah. Sorry, I got cut.
It's okay.
Okay. So now the Government of India guidelines recommend that only insulin should be used before 20 weeks. And if we are going to start insulin, then main thing, the target plasma glucose levels should be very important. Whenever we are going to start treatment, first we'll advise them diet, then exercise. And if it is not controlled with diet and exercise within 2 weeks, then we have to start them on insulin. So the target value in pregnancy is fasting less than 95, 1 hour less than 140, 2 hour less than 120. Anything more than this, we are supposed to start insulin. If the fasting is more than 110, and when pharmacotherapy is required in third trimester also, we can start insulin. Human insulin is recommended since it is least antigenic. And rapid acting insulin analogs like insulin lispro and insulin aspart have been found to be safe, but they are expensive. So need to assess the women's socioeconomic condition to start the medicines. Okay. And the combination of short acting and intermediate acting in the proportion of 30 to 70 twice daily, we call neutral and rapid. Okay. Rapid will initially, when we give, it will decrease the sugar levels fast. Intermediate acting is given in the night to reduce the fasting levels, and rapid will control the postprandial levels. Okay. I hope you are clear with the diabetic management, because it must have been dealt in detail in your medicine also. Yes or no?
Ma'am, we didn't start with medicine classes on GDM yet, ma'am.
Okay. You'll not get medicine classes on GDM. You'll get about diabetes. Okay. Anyway, So then you may not know much about your insulin. So you just remember insulin as a treatment for women who are not controlled with medical nutritional therapy. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So you need to start them on insulin in the proportion of 30:70, at least twice daily, that is before breakfast and before dinner. And whenever we are starting insulin, we usually check sugar values, that is called glycemic profile. We either take 5-point profile or 7-point profile. That means we have to take before and after each meal. Okay. Before breakfast, after breakfast, before lunch, before dinner, after dinner. That comes as 6 values. Then one at 3 a.m. to note whether the woman is going for a low sugar in the middle of the night. Based on that, we'll be able to adjust the night dose of insulin. Okay. Am I clear?
Yes,
Making
ma'am.
some sense? Okay. So main thing, insulin therapy will be short, intermittent. So short acting insulin at bedtime if post dinner glucose is high. Pre lunch if post lunch glucose is high. Human insulin is used. Human insulin analogs like rapid acting is safe. Long acting not recommended. Okay. And OHAs, mainly they are used as an alternative to insulin since insulin has several disadvantages like need for multiple doses. She has to take the insulin injections on her own self. You need to train the women to take injections to monitor the maintenance of temperature as well as to carefully handle the needles because sometimes after so many use, the needles may become blunt. And some women, they do not like to take injections. Poor acceptance of injections and need for self-administration, storage, frequent glucose monitoring. Because sometimes a woman may take insulin, she become hypoglycemic. If you do not monitor, then it is very important she may go for hypoglycemia unawareness. So you need to educate her properly. Then the two OHAs which are commonly used will be metformin and glibenclamide. Metformin is the accepted as first-line treatment when the gestational age is more than 20 weeks by the Ministry of Health, that is the Government of India guideline. So you can either ask them to monitor self-glucose monitoring by using a CBG machine, timing either fasting postprandial 1 or 2 hours after meal, frequency daily till euglycemia is achieved and twice weekly thereafter. Okay. Obstetric management. So remember metformin and glibenclamide are the two drugs which are used. Dosage will be 500 to 2000 milligram per day, depending on the amount of sugar levels. It is useful in obese women with GDM. Additional insulin may be required in some women. Glibenclamide is the first OHA studied in pregnancy. The dose is around 2.5 milligram per day, but can be increased till 20 milligram. But compliance is better with OHA, especially in developing countries like us, where storage of insulin, self-administration, self-glucose monitoring are difficult. Coming to the main management, the obstetric management. So obstetric management will be antepartum, intrapartum, and postpartum. Okay. Antepartum, like if you have started the women on medical nutritional therapy, you can go just monitor her like a normal pregnancy, as there may not be much complications. But if she is on medicine like metformin or insulin, then we require to have a fetal surveillance weekly or once in 2 weeks. You have to make it as a high-risk pregnancy. From 32 weeks, you have to monitor once in 2 weeks and maybe delivered at 38 weeks if she is taking insulin. Since waiting beyond that can increase the risk of macrosomia, shoulder dystocia, sudden intrauterine fetal demise. Okay. So this is a high risk means you have to ask her to come frequently, unlike normal women. And you need to monitor the sugar levels, look for the ultrasound to see if there is a fetal macrosomia that can be diagnosed by checking the abdominal circumference of the baby. Okay. Any women with GDM, you're going to do ultrasound for gestational age in first trimester to confirm whether her dates are correct. Then based on MNT, exercise, insulin or OHA, whichever you're giving, you will write it in the notebook, document it clearly and do ultrasound to look for anomalies. In GDM, the anomaly is very less. And then evaluate for macrosomia between 28 and 32 weeks. You know, if she is diagnosed with GDM, no need to do OGCT. Okay. OGCT is a test only to diagnose GDM. Am I clear, Kartika?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. If you have already diagnosed, don't go and do a OGCT for a diabetic woman or a GDM woman. Okay. Then if there is no macrosomia by ultrasound, also check the BP and urine albumin sugar. Okay. There is no macrosomia, no hypertension or prior stillbirth, controlled on diet. You need to go for routine fetal surveillance like any other pregnancy and deliver at 40 weeks. That is term. Okay. If there is a risk of macrosomia, hypertension, prior stillbirth, controlled with insulin or OHA, then carefully monitor the fetal well-being using a biophysical profile. You have all heard about biophysical profile, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Biophysical profile and fetal surveillance with CTG from 32 weeks. Okay. NST, you'll be seeing the Likert volume. Likert volume with CTG is modified biophysical profile. But if you have time, you are supposed to do fetal tone, fetal breathing and fetal movements. And you need to plan delivery at 38 weeks. And delivery mainly depends. You have to deliver in an institutional care. And also you should have your obstetrician, anesthetist, neonatologist and blood if required. Okay. So mainly intrapartum monitor for parabdomen, the uterine contractions, the strength, the frequency of the contractions and the presentation, the lie, the position of the fetus and the fetal heart. During labor, it is a high-risk pregnancy. You have to put her on a continuous electronic monitoring. And you need to, after doing a parvovaginal examination to see for the Bishop score, modified Bishop score, you see the cervical dilatation, the effacement, the station, the position, you see the baby's condition and you plot a partogram. Once, you know, she has crossed 4-5 centimeter and watch for descent of the fetal head. Sometimes there can be arrest of the descent if there is a big baby. And monitor the fetal heart rate continuously. Anticipate shoulder dystocia when you know there is a delay in the second stage. You have to maintain that. Once you are starting her on induction, you need to monitor the fasting plasma glucose and also you have to stop the insulin on the day of induction. You have to monitor the glucose. You have to keep the target to just between 70 to 130 and GDM on diet, you need to monitor the blood glucose during labor. 4 to 6 early and administer insulin if only required if the sugar levels are very high. And if she is a GDM on insulin, continue insulin the day prior, stop insulin in the morning, intravenous infusion of 5% dextrose before induction. And sometimes during delivery, if there is a obstetric indication, you may need to plan for an emergency C-section. Or if the baby weight is more than 4.5 kg estimated, go for an elective cesarean section in the morning hours. Don't do as a last case. Plan her as a first case. And monitor the sugar levels immediately after delivery. In GDM, usually following the delivery of the placenta, the sugar levels come down and there may not be requirement for insulin following delivery. Because placenta is the main culprit. You know, I was talking to you about the placental insulinase as well. So monitor the capillary glucose hourly and if required during delivery, you have to add soluble insulin to the drip if the sugar levels are high and titrate the dose to maintain target glucose level. And the postpartum, since the level comes down to normal, you may not require to give her a insulin following delivery, but you need to monitor whether she is able to remember 5 Bs. You need to check for the breast, the baby, the bleeding, the bowel and the bladder. Okay, these are the 5 things in the postpartum you need to monitor for a woman. And since the insulin level falls, requirement falls, you need to repeat the sugar levels following delivery. And the women may not require insulin in the postnatal period. And the glucose level should be tested 24 hours after delivery. And also about postpartum, they have to be given diet, exercise and lifestyle modification to lose weight postnatally after 6 months. And you need to perform a 75 gram GTT at 6 weeks after delivery. Either we can do fasting postprandial and find out whether these GDM women, they have a higher tendency to form a type 2 diabetic women. That is 50% of the GDM during pregnancy, they tend to have a diabetes in later life. So So postpartum GTT values, if they are abnormal, they should be referred to a physician to be managed as a case of diabetes. So I think I will stop here because the GDM management will be over. But I would like you to ask questions. If it's okay, I can continue with the diabetes management.
Yes, ma'am.
Shall I continue or you want to ask questions? I don't know whether only you are answering, so whether others are alert or not.
Ma'am, we can continue, ma'am.
Okay. So, now the GDM part is over. Diabetes is something which is, she has had earlier to pregnancy. So, that means there is a high chance of she developing risk like nephropathy, retinopathy, coronary heart disease. So, these are complications pertaining to diabetes in a woman. So, nephropathy, there can be high risk of preeclampsia, worsening of proteinuria and worsening of hypertension. And retinopathy, there can be worsening of proliferative retinopathy and vitreous hemorrhage. Coronary heart disease, you know, there can be silent myocardial infarction leading on to maternal mortality in these women. So, you need to monitor the diabetic women for conditions like nephropathy, retinopathy and coronary heart disease. If the woman is already a diabetic nephropathy and she is conceiving, then she may be taking some drugs for her hypertension like ACE inhibitors, you know, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. If they are going to take these drugs and they are going to conceive, then the baby may have some fetal anomalies like anuria and renal agenesis. So if you diagnose pregnancy in a woman who has had ACE inhibitors and conceived, you need to stop the medicine within 2 working days and put her on another medicine like labetalol, which is safe in pregnancy for hypertension. And usually these women, when they are switched from ACE inhibitors to another medicine, the complications to the mother and baby is very less. And retinopathy, it is important to have a good glycemic control to prevent the complications in the mother. And also, the women should be sent to an ophthalmologist to get opinion for her fundus and also to find out if she doesn't have complications, she can be allowed to continue. Or she may have to have a pan-retinal photocoagulation. It is important to maintain the HbA1c level less than 6.5. Anything more than 6.5 or a random blood glucose more than 200, you need to think of diabetes. Even if you diagnose first time in pregnancy, it's called diabetes. So if the HbA1c is more than 10 during conception and the first 10 weeks of pregnancy, there is a high chance of these babies having a diabetic embryopathy. I was talking to you about anomalies in the form of anencephaly, microcephaly, congenital heart disease, mermaid baby, caudal regression. So you need to keep that in mind and you have to tell them, if the HbA1c values are high, the baby may have some anomalies. But if she has conceived, we usually don't advise termination. We monitor them till second trimester by doing the anomaly scan. If it is less than 6.5% HbA1c, that is, they may not have much complications. So it is important, diabetes mellitus women go for a preconceptional counseling to have a folic acid 5 mg to prevent neural tube defects, to have a good tight control, to have HbA1c less than 6.5, to optimize the weight and also assess each every condition in our body like nephropathy, retinopathy and also the cardiac condition. So you need to check for serum creatinine, urine protein, microalbumin, ophthalmic, ECG, echo and TSH. Start her on oral hypoglycemics and if she is on ACE and ARB for hypertension, continue with another medication which is safe during pregnancy. And achieve a good sugar control and then start her on pregnancy. Once she is pregnant, it is important to maintain the glucose levels. If she is on oral hypoglycemics or on insulin, to have a good target fasting, 1 hour, 2 hours. No need to do a OGCT for a patient who is already found to be diabetic. So you have to put them on diet as well as exercise and also oral hypoglycemics like metformin, glimethylclobide and insulin. And the obstetric. In the first trimester, give adequate counseling regarding weight gain, diet, exercise, pharmacotherapy, and also check the ultrasound in the first trimester to find out accurate gestational age. And also, anomaly scan is very important. Folic acid should be in a high dose, and low dose aspirin should be started from 12 weeks to prevent gestational hypertension. Second trimester, do scan every 2 to 4 weeks. And also check for BP, weight gain, glycemic control, and detailed assessment of the fetal heart is very important between 18 to 24 weeks. Echocardiography to rule out cardiac anomalies. Third trimester, again check the BP, the obstetric assessment, polyhydramnios, macrosomia, growth restriction, urine examination for proteinuria, and at 28 weeks, fetal growth should be evaluated. And also, we need to check her retinopathy, nephropathy, glycemic status, and as I mentioned, everything, diet, exercise, insulin, self-monitoring of blood glucose if she's on insulin, ultrasound, and look for anomalies. And this is the about the antenatal management. In the management, during your third trimester, you have to do close fetal survey, as there is a high chance of becoming a macrosomia baby or a growth restricted baby. You have to start them to assess at 28 weeks, once in 2 to 4 weeks. Then weekly or twice weekly if the sugar levels are poorly controlled or there is FGR. You have to do a Doppler like umbilical artery and middle cerebral artery if there is FGR, and polyhydramnios should be checked. Non-stress test you can start from 32 weeks and weekly as a primary test itself. Twice weekly is indicated if the primary test is at the problem. You need to time the delivery. Mainly I told you if she has got a very good glucose control, you can deliver at 38 weeks, and poor control, you can deliver at 37, 38 weeks. In those cases, you may need to give them steroids. If you give steroids for lung maturity, their sugar levels may go high up. So you need to monitor the sugar levels when you are giving them steroids. If there is a worsening preeclampsia or there is a vasculopathy or a fetal compromise, you can go and deliver even early. You can deliver by vaginal route, but there is a high chance of shoulder dystocia in a macrosomia baby having a brachial plexus injury. You can find out or predict macrosomia by doing abdominal circumference and fetal weight to some extent, but they are having a poor predictive value. So any baby more than 4.5 kg, directly go and do a cesarean if it is a pre-gestational diabetes or a overt diabetes. Intrapartum, try to monitor the sugar levels by doing a careful sugar monitoring. And also in the postpartum, you need to again check her sugar levels. She may require insulin in the postpartum, unlike a woman with GDM who may not require. It is important to put them on a contraception, proper contraception, either a temporary method or a permanent method, depending on the parity. Permanent method may not be suitable in some women, as they pediatrician may not give consent, and the baby may develop complication in the postnatal period in a diabetic woman, like hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, hyperbilirubinemia, respiratory distress syndrome, and also polycythemia. So you need to keep all these in mind and give them a temporary contraceptive method, like low-dose oral contraceptive pills or progesterone pills, injectable progesterone, which is available in the government as Antara. IUCDs you can very well insert. They do not cause any type of infection. And it is important to counsel them and to offer them a permanent method of sterilization once the baby is well enough. Okay. Any doubts? I think I was very fast.
Ma'am, actually, why should we stop the insulin during induction, ma'am? Induction of labor?
You may have a hypoglycemia.
Okay.
Which may be very difficult to treat. You have to take over the control of sugar levels, because sometimes you may have to take a cesarean in the patient and you may not be able to monitor the sugars. So you need to carefully monitor the sugars by doing a CBG, stop insulin, and you can start insulin infusion, which can, you know, control the sugar levels well. Throughout it will be coming, instead of, you know, multiple subcutaneous injection. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
The baby will be utilizing sugars during delivery as well. She may go for hypoglycemia, unawareness, or hyperglycemia. So you need to continuously monitor the sugar levels.
Yes, ma'am.
You need to achieve the target level. Any doubts? Anyone other than Kartika?
Ma'am, can you repeat the Doppler, ma'am?
Doppler.
went to,
So Doppler we usually do when the woman is a diabetic. In diabetes type 1 and type 2, there is a high chance of the baby having a fetal growth restriction. So you need to do the umbilical artery Doppler, which is the major feeding vessel for the baby, between 26 to 28 weeks. Usually, the umbilical artery Doppler should have a low resistance flow. If there is a high resistance, low resistance means a good flow of the blood to the baby. Low resistance la nalla fill aagum. If the baby has got a high resistance, then there is a chance that the baby's blood flow is not adequate, then the baby can have a FGR. To prevent FGR, we are starting aspirin from 12 weeks onwards in a woman with diabetes. Am I clear?
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
So you start umbilical artery Doppler, repeat every 2 weeks. If everything goes on smoothly, you continue. If there is a problem in the umbilical artery Doppler, I told you high resistance or a positive end diastolic, or absent or reversed. If there is absent flow or a reversal of flow, then the baby is going to suffer hypoxia and hypo, like the blood flow is decreased. Then you need to monitor for the middle cerebral artery Doppler. The middle cerebral artery Doppler is the Doppler which supplies blood to the brain. If the brain supply is also compromised, then there is no use of continuing the pregnancy inside. You need to deliver the baby and give it in the proper NICU. Okay. MCA Doppler is telling that the cerebral perfusion is good. If by doing that, if you find out the cerebroplacental ratio is less than one, that means the brain is also not receiving adequate blood supply. There is no use of continuing the baby inside. You may need to deliver the baby and keep it outside. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Any other questions? And the final will be the ductus venosus Doppler that is done for a preterm, okay, not in a term fetus. If it is also having absent flow, then you need to terminate by giving a course of steroids. In that case, we may need to directly do a cesarean section instead of allowing for a vaginal delivery, okay. Any doubts?
Ma'am, caudal regression syndrome and renal agenesis, does the baby survive, ma'am?
காடல் ரெக்ரெஷன்னா சேக்ரம் இருக்காது, சேக்ரல் ஏஜெனசிஸ். பேபி சர்வைவல் ப்ராப்ளம் இருக்காது. மெர்மேட் பேபின்னு சொல்றோம் இல்லையா, கடல் தண்ணின்னு ஒரு கால் பார்க்லாம் இருக்காது. ரொம்ப பேபி சர்வைவல் பிரச்சனை இருக்காது, கம்ப்ளீட் அனாமலியா இருக்கும். வி கான்ட் யூனோ ஹாவ் அ குட் ப்ரோக்னோசிஸ் ஃபார் த பேபி. அலைவா பறக்கும், பட் அதுக்கப்புறம் சர்வைவல் இருக்காது. If we diagnose such conditions, we usually don't allow the pregnancy to continue. 20 weeks, we'll be able to find out. That too, if the woman comes as a late booker. Usually, if the HbA1c is very high and she conceives, we have a careful monitoring by doing a NT serum markers, dual marker like PAP-A and beta-HCG in the first trimester between 11 to 13 weeks plus 6 days. NT scan 11 to 13 weeks plus 6 days la pandra. Serum markers, if they show a high risk, then we go and do a target scan early, 18 to 20 weeks. If required, a fetal echo at 20 to 24 weeks. If there is an abnormality, we give a counseling to the women using the fetal medicine unit and the geneticist. If they offer a termination, we advise them termination early if there is a congenital anomaly in the baby, which is not compatible with life. Okay. Caudal regression syndrome or sacral agenesis is more pathognomonic. But cardiac anomalies are more common in a diabetic baby.
Okay.
Pathognomonic na diabetic baby la adhi irukkum. If it is there, you know it is only due to diabetes. But the most common na ketangna, you have to say cardiac anomalies, not caudal regression. Okay.
Okay.
Caudal regression is present means it is a diabetic anomaly. But diabetes liver a common anomaly is cardiac anomaly. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Any questions? If no questions, then we'll take attendance and we'll close. Kartika, have you taken attendance?
No, ma'am. I'll take it now, ma'am.
Okay. You'll send me the list?
Yes, ma'am, I'll send you the list now.
Okay. Shall we stop now? Or
Yes,
anyone
ma'am.
has doubts?
Ma'am, of the cardiac anomalies,
Should
gestational diabetes mellitus,
I? Yeah.
which is the most common one
Cardiac anomalies?
in gestational diabetes
Common
mellitus?
one. Gestational diabetes la varadu. Gestational diabetes, I told you, you don't get anomalies. You get anomalies in a diabetes only, not in gestational. We can get septal defects.
Okay, ma'am. Ventricular septal defect will be the most common, or
yeah, most likely. But
thanks.
They usually have a combination. VSD can be there, but the combination of.
Okay, ma'am.
VSD mainly transposition of great vessels, tetralogy of Fallot. But you may have a VSD. Only சொல்ல முடியாது. Okay, wow. VSD is common in இது. But you can get that VSD even in your Down syndrome. Cardiac anomaly பார்த்தேன்னா you think diabetesல இருக்கலாம் அப்படின்றதுதான். Diabetic baby, diabetic mother having a baby, the commonest anomaly will be cardiac. Cardiacல VSD. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Am I clear? Perimembranous VSD can also be present in Down syndrome.
Yes, ma'am.
So, remember VSD, cardiac anomaly, common in diabetic. Any questions, pa? Shall we stop? You may have next class, no? It's going to be 12.
Yes, ma'am.
Then I'll close.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for your patient listening, pa. Thank you.